Once you have a programmer, you're never done. We had an internal developer. We do a lot of technical translation, a lot of life sciences, primarily safety data support. So I've spoken with a couple of people here who are in that same universe, and we are completely on the same wavelength. But if you're not familiar with that field, you'll see some of the challenges here. A lot of this is going to deal with standardization. How many here are ISO 9001 certified? Seven. With me makes eight. And one of the reasons I say that is you can be ISO certified to 17100, you can be some other standards, EN15038, but they don't get to the quality management system the way the ISO 9001 series does. And it requires standardization at a very different level. It brings a very different thought process to the organization. I think it's critical to the success of being able to move data. How many here have the same convention for naming your language pairs that your clients do? How about your translators? Yeah, because they're all freelancers, you're very fortunate you can even align with one of those pieces. Clients do not name them the same way, you have to adapt. That's part of straightening out that hose. So where to begin? Yes, in the beginning there was chaos. When we wanted to integrate with MemoQ, we looked, of course, at the API and with our system, and what we found was there were huge gaps. Everything we thought we had in place and were ready to do required going back, reworking. Sometimes the functionality just was not there. And again, a lot of it goes to data organization. And of course, you always underestimate how long and how much it will take and how much it will cost. And for us, one of the ways we've been able to afford a developer is that we pick them up out of college, sometimes even as an intern or a co-op while they're in college, and give them experience using a real-world system. Well, that does two things. One, it gives them a lot of exposure and training, but they're learning on your time, so you can't always expect professional development. And then quite often they get a job and they leave, so you've just boosted their career at the expense of some of your work, and you have to go through and redo again. But the other benefit is you get someone who's young, they're eager to learn, they're working very hard, and you can find some really good diamonds in the rough. So, client file formats. How many here can take what the client sends and put it directly into their CAT tools? One? Two? Three, maybe? Yes, for everything else, there is an intermediate step that has to occur. And in a lot of cases, that is a big monkey wrench in what would otherwise be a smooth process. How many deal with spreadsheets? Do all your clients have the same columns for source and target? Yes. This is a huge problem for us in that even within the client, they don't keep the same format. So that was another huge challenge, and we'll cover that a little later in terms of trying to beat them in the consistency. Then we get the most bizarre instructions. We want you to do only the highlighted cells, and there'll be a source listing of languages and phrases to do, and then there'll be 30 or 40 tabs that say which ones of those apply with the highlighted cell going across. Only do the yellow highlighted, but not with blue text. So that was another problem. And we did not know enough to ask the correct questions to the client. So even to say, how do we get this into something that's workable? How do you approach them on that? What are you really trying to get to? So you've got to be able to work with your clients on that end of it, as well as your translators, to get this whole thing straightened out. So if your client says, no, we are company XYZ and we are so big that we will never change, or we can't change, you just have to work with what we give you, then that's kind of a dead end discussion. You've got to figure it out. But if they're saying, well, yes, we all want to do this better, and there may be pain at the client that you don't know, they're trying to give you something and it's causing them pain for them to give it to you in what they think is the format you want, when really, you know, they could do something much easier and get it to you with less pain on their end as well. So you could have a lot of benefits straightening out the pipe for everybody. And then proper messaging is critical. You're not doing this with the client for your benefit. You're doing it for their benefit. And it's gonna benefit them in better quality, reduced cost, faster cycle times. You have to pitch it to them in the way that they want to do it. So we had our own proprietary TMS, and we wanted to integrate NetworkQ. And we've had this as an annual goal for the last 5 years. And every year it comes and goes, and so we keep it up there. And it took a lot more to get there than what we thought. For one thing, it required the right developer. We finally got that. And so he has become very critical. And he knew nothing about the industry, he knew nothing about MemoQ when he started the work. But he's the kind of guy who will go out and figure it out. And he's very, very diligent. And I know the staff at Kilgrave probably hate to see emails coming from him. But he has caused them to pick up the pace quite a bit in terms of the API. And so you have to do everything in sequence. You have an ideal end state, but you can't just jump there. There's a lot of intermediate steps that you either have planned out or you stumbled across along the way. And quite often you're moving along just fine and all of a sudden you realize, oh, we don't have this whole thing. Or what we had is a mess. We really have to clean this up before we can implement this. And so each of those aha moments brings a huge effort either in organizing that data that you didn't have organized or creating it from scratch. Everything becomes a new challenge. And again, being able to prioritize what comes first, what goes before the other step, what do we have before we can do that? We want to automate things, we want to automate all these project management tasks, but in order to do that, you have to have all your QA centers, and they're unique to each client. You have to have the lists that have been talked about in some of the other translator rules. So yes, you want to get there, but you don't have that list. Standardized names for languages, standardized names for everything. And again, you'll never be done. So the MemoQ functionality, and this is not to be critical of MemoQ. It's a large and complicated program. I say, you know, it's one thing being a translation company, it's quite another being a software vendor. A lot of people have asked us to make our TMS available. And I said, I don't want to do it. I don't want to have to support thousands of needy users and have to produce regular updates. But over the last 10 years, we started with MemoQ 3.0, I believe, was where we were at. Now we're up to 8.4. So if you think about all those changes that have been published over that time, how many things have evolved? You wanted to get there, but that capability didn't exist. File type and format filters. That's come a long way. One of the things that we ran into was you could filter based on the non-highlighted cells. And we said, well, that's nice, but we need to filter on the highlighted ones. So can you flip that around? And they did. Then there's two different, and I always call them thinking or the logic of the way the programs work. So our TMS has one way of thinking, MemoQ has another way of thinking. Those two ways of thinking have to align. So whatever system you're using, have to see eye to eye at some point. And that can be painful, because if your system is designed in a way that it functions only like this, and the tool you're integrating with only works this way, sometimes that can be a very big thing to bridge. Then your ability to tell your programmer, or even come back to the tool maker with what you want. How do you define your criteria? And you say, well, we want it to do this. And if you tell them we want it to have wings and fly, they'll say, great, we'll start making wings and we'll make it fly. And you go, well, no, we really didn't want that. We wanted this thing to fly and be able to land and see over the hill. And they go, oh, well, we just made it fly. That's what you asked for. And you're going, oh, I got the change, but it wasn't really the change I needed. So you've got to be able to very carefully define what it is you want this thing to do. And think it through, because you may be trying to solve one problem, and it would solve that, but there may be variations on that that you don't think about. Or things that will break it, or things that break existing processes. And you fix that problem but cause three others over here. So you've always got to be looking at a bigger picture and saying, how does this change affect everything else? And then the question became, how many new features can we really ask in a code grading MOQ to do? And we came to this discussion recently, and they said, well, yeah, we see there's value in doing this new feature, but you're the only one asking for it. And we need to have enough users ask for something for it to hit a priority on the implementation side. So in reality, everybody's resource constrained. I may want it to do this, but if nobody else out here wants it to do that, probably it won't get done, or I'll have to fund it myself. But that's not going to happen either. So one of the biggest issues was data management. And even though we say we are ISO certified, that doesn't mean that everything was standardized. And really, you have to standardize everything. And this becomes a challenge when you're dealing with legacy. And so we can say we're going to implement a new standard today, but what about the stuff that was not standardized before? How much of that has value that we have to fix? How much effort do you spend making it backward compatible? Or do you just say we don't want it to break when it goes back? Because we're not going to use data that we've had 12 years ago, but we don't want it to fail when it goes back and tries to find something that wasn't there. We've added so much quality control, we've added so much new things to the process that simply don't exist in the older work. Well, that's fine, we don't need it there, we just don't want it to break when it goes back and tries to see one of those old jobs. And so we talked about language pairs, we talked about file names, we also came up with filters. And so we said, yeah, that's great. Let's go out and create filters. We have so many different clients that have different settings. We want to standardize filters that we can apply. And they said, yep, great. So we start making filters. Well, wait a minute. How do we name these filters in a way that we can go back and put some organization in defining the filters? So again, have to go back and redefine what is our file name for the filters, filter name. It doesn't have to be a 3-hour meeting. It can be a 10-minute, hey, let's get together. Okay, we're all in agreement? Let's go. And we talked, I heard somebody else say about automation and the desire to automate everything. And I am very much of that background. So I feel like if it's something somebody's doing manually, they got their own little spreadsheet, whatever, I want to automate it. I don't want that sitting in their desk. But in reality, you want certain decision points built in that require someone to stop, think about what they're doing, and say, yes, this is correct. It's not just automatic. So we could have our system, as soon as the request comes in, just spit out a quote and send it back. But I guarantee that probably 95% of those will be wrong. So not only do we don't do that, We also want a second set of eyes looking at every quote and making sure that all the things that are in there are correct and does it make sense from a business perspective. And so, yes, you can tell a machine, we always want these parameters, but it's so subjective when you're doing that that you don't want to leave it up to a machine. And you may say, we always want a 50% margin. And then you get a huge job comes in, your 50% margin prices you way out, and if it goes out, you lost. So it's that kind of subjective insight that the AI will probably never have. So it's your clients, your staff, and your linguists must agree to abide by the standards. And that sounds easier, especially if you have a small business, it is easier. The larger your business becomes, the harder that is. And how do you know when they don't abide by the standard? How many here do manual entry for creating a new TM? Pretty much everybody? No? Two? Your system generates all your TMs? Project managers don't create new ones? Do they all name them the same? How do you enforce that? How do you enforce that?
How do I enforce it? Because I'm the only one in the company that makes it. So.
There you go. He's the only one doing it. And yes, you do get very good, well, most of the time you get good data integrity if you're the only one doing it. But how many of them have different people creating it? Yes.
Templates.
Yeah, I mean, just take care of most of it.
If you have created templates, how do you name your templates?
That's a good point.
And that's exactly what I'm saying, is that every time you have something that you think, this is going to really help me, you go back and you look at it 3 months, 6 months later, and what you see is a whole listing of where you had this great idea and you did them this way, but then that didn't work, so you had them this way, and now we're all going to do them this way, but nobody went back and renamed the other ones. And that's exactly how these things snowball, to the point where a few years down the road, you're looking at going, oh, geez, now I've got 500 of these things I got to go back and fix. So getting all three pieces aligned is very difficult. Your foundation has to be right before you start building or correct it early on. So whatever it is that you're looking to do, you really want to make sure that you have played with it enough before you commit to it to say, yes, this is how we really want to do it. And it's okay to experiment in the beginning. You can say, well, we think this is the best way we're going to do this. We're going to name it this way. We're going to try it. And we'll see what we run into in practice. Give it 2 months. Give it a 3 month trial. And say, okay, let's come back. What did we like about it? What didn't we like about it? What would we change? Let's finalize on that and go forward. Let's just not live with what we created knowing it was bad. Because it'll be much harder to fix it 2 years down the road. So again, the team effort works if everyone's doing it exactly the same way. If you have everyone buying in except for one person who says that's a really dumb idea, I'm going to go with it, they want to do it, but I disagree completely, I'm going to think it is better to do it this way. If you don't round that person up and bring them in, they could be out doing it differently. And not to say they would ever lie, but they're probably not going to expose the fact that they're doing it differently. You're going to have to find them. And so again, this is not a one-time fix. This is long-term. You're always going to be cleaning out data. Client names. How many have the same client in their systems with different names? Company names. Yes. And again, if you have more than one person doing the data entry, you get that problem. So, what does fulfillment look like? Well, we have standard file formats for all the major clients. And again, that's not saying all clients. That's the major clients that are submitting the highest volumes of work that require the most PM time. So MemoQ integration is probably going to always be somewhere between 80 and 90% complete, because they'll come out with new features. We'll have new needs. We're always going to be changing. We're getting suggestions and giving suggestions for bug feature or bug fixes, new features on a regular basis. So the users, the PMs have bought into it. They're actively suggesting improvements. Standardized processes are in place. The data is all very nicely clean and organized. And so the challenge becomes to maintain that and to improve. So here's where we love to be. Files come in, they require very little handling and manipulation, they're loaded automatically. Everything's properly assigned. Linguists are assigned, they get the maximum leverage because all the correct TMs are applied. We get reduced project administration time, reduced error rates, and increased client satisfaction on it. And that's the real goal, is to enable the PMs to do more. So that covers that part. And we have questions, but what I'd like to do real quick,
okay, questions,
is to take you through just a real quick demo. And this is actually our system. All right, so what I've done is I've just created the project in MemoQ. If I need to, I can get the client stats, it's just one file, I can fill work counts. But down here is where we apply those filters. This one is automatically paired with this company and has the correct source column and various other information, whether the first row is a header or not, what the colors are, all that's contained in there. So that when I go to MemoQ, specific that the PM may select for that particular project that would have a CS designation. You have domain global resources where they have a DG designation and it says anything in this domain gets applied. Now you can use the four attributes that are in there, but again there's limitations with some of that. And so that depends a lot on your people putting that data in consistently every single time. Because if you rely on that as part of your structure, it's got to be right. What this does is it gives us the flexibility to group things by time frame. Typically, we organize client TMs by year. But But then we can also have domain specific, and then translator global, translator specific, and then we can also do an admin global. And this applies for any of the things, the term bases, QA settings, everything can be aligned this way. And that way, when you create the project, everything is done, and you're getting the maximum leverage because everything has been correctly assigned. Any questions?
Questions? Anyone?
Yes.
If I noticed correctly in your demo, you are not using project templates, right? Is that a reason?
Many of the reasons were because we did not find that they had the flexibility we needed that the naming convention gave us with the resources. Every time we try to have something templated, the clients throw us another curve.
Other questions?
Thank you. I'm trying to clean up your TMs. Sometimes you have several TMs for the customer because of the reasons that you mentioned. And when trying to merge them, what are the criteria that MemoQ uses to determine which is the best translation unit, and if we can modify those parameters used by MemoQ?
Do you have an answer for that?
Sometimes we have several, or sometimes we want to use the TMs from different customers, different clients, because they have, for instance, a main customer, and both will be used for the same purpose. So when merging them, sometimes MemoQ does not ask what are the preferences to decide which is the best TM, depending on date or depending on if it is reviewed already. So I'm not clear about how is that MemoQ decides which translation unit will be kept if they're reviewed.
I'm not aware that it makes a decision. It's up to the user, isn't it?
My God, I didn't listen.
I would not rely on MemoQ to make that decision for me. I would want to go out and do those CMs and know for sure I'm getting the best pair coming in. I would not leave that up to how arbitrarily it might be decided. And so what we would do is go through the TM separately.
Sometimes when you merge them, they have the same source. And I don't know if it decides by date or by being reviewed.
Yeah, that was going to be my question. Why would you merge them?
Because I've been using for the same source, sometimes they repeat.
You can use both, but you can keep both TMs. Yeah.
Sometimes it does not replace the other. So what's the criteria?
Separate TMs.
I'm afraid I need to stop this conversation. let's continue later on, but we need to carry on.
Yes. Any other questions of time?
Would you mind to ask Dr. directly later on?
Yeah,
because we have to go on with the next session. Okay, great.